So if you run a bunch of models, let's say 100 models with the same input data, this is a normal behavior of the models in this error space, in which we plot the commission and the emission error, and we plot all the models that we run. Okay? So from this information, we can decide which models are good and which models are bad. Let's see. This is the distribution area, and these are our points for each one of these models. And each one of these points represent one output of GARP, one model of GARP. In this part of the plot, we have very high omission and very low commission error. We know that we can trust in our presence data, but our absence data, as Victor mentioned and Tom mentioned, is not that reliable because it's very difficult to confirm the absence of the species. So our strong dating here is our omission error, more than our commission error. So if we have models with high omission, it's meaning that many of the points, validation points, are not predicted by the model. So this model is not performing well here. Okay? On the other extreme, we can do very well at predicting our presences if we predict the whole region. If we over-predict, we will have zero omission error, but also this represents a bad move because it's overlapping predicting the distribution of the species. So we know that this part of the plot and this part of the plot, the models are not good. But there are also problems if we could have models in this part of the plot, because this means that they are overfitted. So these are the three problems that we can find in the model. So we can set a limit at the omission axis that we can accept an error. This is the E that I was mentioning you yesterday. How much error are you going to accept based on how good is your input data, okay? For example, here it's about 10% of error. We can say that models above this limit, we are not going to accept them because they are not performing well. So we remain with this set of models that have acceptable omission error, but also we know that models that go to this extreme of the axis may be overfitting, and the models that are going to this other side of the plot may be overpredicting. So the region of the good models should fall somewhere here. So these ideas has been implemented in the algorithm, both in the standalone software and in the open model. So right now we are going into open modeler and see how to parameterize GARP in the program. So if you open your open modeler, go to the algorithm profiles, you see the list of your algorithms, and you see that you have here four implementations of GARP. The first one says GARP single run, best of GARP implementation. It
means that you are going to run only one model. This is a single run with GARP for the new open model implementation. When they recoded GARP for having it here in open model, they make some changes, some subtle changes. But those changes resulted that performed better than the original implementation of GARP. So we recommend you to use the new open model implementation in any case. Then you have these other two options in which you can include this best subset implementation. So for now we are going to run this GARP with best subsets, the new open model implementation. Okay. We are going to modify the default parameters, so you need to plumb it again. So you have here a copy of GARP with best subset implementations and go to parameters. And you will see here a set, a number of parameters that we can change. The first one says training proportion, which is the partition of your points. How many? The percentage of points that you want for training. Let's go for 75, as we did in Python. Then it says the total runs. How many models do you want to produce? Because we are, in effect, running several models. In this case, it says 20. GARP is like a very machine demanding software, and it takes much longer than Maxent or than Python. So the higher the number you use in that option, it will take much more longer to finish up your analysis. So we are going to leave this in 20 for now. But normally you want to use 50 or 100 models to have full like variation of the models. Then you have this option of hard omission threshold. This refers to the green line that we set here in this graph. Is what percentage of omission errors you are accepting for a model to decide that this is a good one or not a good one? Is this green line here? So we can set it here in 10%. We are saying that models that have more than 10% of omission error are going to be discarded. Okay? If you read here the instructions down here, it says set to 100% use soft omission. What is that? If we leave here 100%, we are not establishing any line in this omission axis. But it's going to run all the models and it's going to pick the number of models that you establish in the parameters with the lowest omission error, regardless of its value. It doesn't matter how big or small is that value, but it will take a certain number of models with the lowest omission, okay? When you use 100 here. So we are going to use 10%. We are establishing a hard omission threshold. And we are going to say here that initially, we are asking to run 20 models that selects 10 models with this omission criterion. So we have 20 models, it's going to run 20 models, but it's going to select the 10 models that has 10 or less percent of omission error. Okay? Then it comes to the commission axis. And you are saying here that we are selecting 50% of these 10 models that fall closest to the median. this is kind of confusing, I know. But remember always this graph for you to make the decisions in these parameters. We are saying here that for the 20 models that we originally run, we are going to keep 10, which are these 10, right? And from these 10, we are going to select 50% of them, in other words, five models that are closest to the median. We are selecting these ones, okay? This means this parameter. And the other parameters are irrelevant for what we are doing now. Some of them are, if you are running in more than one machine at the same time, it's better. Now you apply the changes of your parameters and close. Now you can run a new experiment with this parameterization. Open a new experiment screen, give a name, let's say line chart. Select only the line, and in this case you are going to select the copy one of GARP as the algorithm to run the model. Then you would use the layers in Africa present. The projection settings is going to be Africa present. Your template is going to be one of the layers in the Africa layer set. You can use the same directory as the output because you are running a different algorithm, so it's going to be a different subdirectory to this directory, so it's fine, it's there. And just put it to run. Don't be surprised if in some machines doesn't run, or if it breaks down, or your machine doesn't support it, because it's much more intensive, this algorithm. So it sometimes happens that it doesn't run. Yeah. Put your models to run, and we will continue. And in the practical part of these days, of today, we will keep running with your own data, with GARP, with Max, and Pyro. Do you have some questions? Any questions? One important thing when you run models in software that are user-friendly is that you really make an effort to document yourself about how each one of those algorithms work. And don't be like a blind users of these methods. That's going to make a very important difference on the performance of the models.
Okay, so that model is running.
That's
and we're just going to leave it running. Some of these GARP models, back in the old days when we used to use the desktop interface quite a bit, some of them would run for a month. This one's going to run quick, okay?